We read these two passages, and we go for more details. The main thought I have is to talk about the Word of God. What is the Word of God? And we hear this quite often. Only God's Word. We only believe God's Word. And we don't want explanations. We don't want interpretations. But we only want God's Word. Before I forget, I think the brother mentioned also that little William is sick. And he's unwell, so we'll also remember him maybe at the end in our prayers. So there is something which is very serious that it should not be a concern to me only as a preacher, but it should be a concern to every believer, everyone who is meant to take part into the rapture. The Word must be his concern. Why should it be a concern to you? I want all of us to be aware that God hates when men interpret his Word. God hates that. Because no man can interpret God's Word. But God himself, whatever he says, God himself fulfills it. Interpretation is the source of a lot of misunderstanding. Interpretation is whereby we explain, we try to give a meaning to something that God has said. If God has not explained it through his own word, if God has not given us the guidelines on how something has to happen, and then we start explaining it, most of the time, we always get it wrong. That's why we always want to refer to what the Bible says. You read one topic, one subject, in one book, or one verse in one book, you may find the same verse or the same thought in another verse. The second verse makes the first one a little bit clear. You read the third one, it makes it more clear. You read the final one, it brings the whole picture to clarity. But unfortunately, most of the time, it doesn't always remain like that. And this goes back from the Garden of Eden, where we see the first lie, how the devil came and then deceived Eve by twisting the word and giving the wrong meaning to the word and bringing the damage that we all are aware of today. So, as we will go through this part, bear in mind, salvation is individual. There were things Paul could fight for. In 2 Corinthians 11, Paul says, I am fighting, I am doing all my best. I'm jealous of you because I want to present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. So that was his desire. That was his battle. Him, as a man of God, he was fighting in order to present the bride as a chaste virgin. But the bride also has a role to play. So there is what a preacher can do, but there is also what you as a believer can also do. So we are fighting to make sure only the sound doctrine is preached, but at the same time, you also need to watch over yourself, the things you expose yourself to, the things you hear. So all of that, as the Lord said, in Luke chapter 8, we read from verse 11, when the Lord gave the meaning of the parable of the sower, the Lord said, now the parable is this, the seed is the word of God. So So all of us in the lecture, we know what a seed does. So the seed is the word of God. So the seed is the word of God. So the word, the seed, is the word. And all of us know from the nature that any seed, regardless of its kind, regardless of its state, once it falls in the ground, that seed will always reproduce itself. But when the Lord spoke of the parable of the sower, the Lord gave the meaning. And then he said, the seed is the word. And because the seed is the word, faith comes from hearing. And what we hear is what will produce the faith in us. Now, if what we hear is not the word, then the outcome will not be as expected. If we read in in Isaiah 26, a familiar scripture, Isaiah 26, the Bible says here, Isaiah 26, it reads, verse 17, like as a woman with child that draweth near the time of her delivery, is in pain and crieth out in a pang, so have we been in thy sight, O Lord. We've been with child, we've been in pain. We have, as it were, brought forth wind. We have not wrought any deliverance in the earth, neither have the inhabitants of the world fallen. So, the seed is the word. And the word must be kept in its original goal or state, rather, for that word to produce the kind of result that God wants. We read in 2 Peter, still in connection with the word. Let's read all these verses and they will start making sense. 2 Peter chapter 1, we read from verse 1. It states, from verse 19 rather, 2 Peter 1, verse 19. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well, that ye take heed as unto light that shineth in a darkness, until the day dawn. And the day star arise in your heart, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but the holy man of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Keep that thought in you. The thought is this, but the holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So, holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So, it was not the way we see people today writing books. You sit down, you decide. You read other people's books, you take ideas here, you take ideas there, you put them together, and then you change the context or whatever way in the views, and then you make it your own, and then you publish a book. That's not how Isaiah wrote. That's not how Jeremiah wrote. That's not how Micah wrote. That's not how Peter wrote. That's not how Micah wrote, or John, or James, or the book of Revelation, John knew, but rather these men, they were moved by the Spirit of God. God made them to write. God led them, revealed himself to them, and instructed them to write. So, because it is God who moved them, because it is God who instructed them to write, for you to understand what they have written, the same God has to use you and reveal unto you what he has told them. Why? Because whatever God has said, God himself has to explain what he means. Otherwise, we will end up with our own understanding, but which is always, most of the time, contrary to what God said. That's why it's so important for us first to know that God's word cannot become subject of any private interpretation. We cannot take God's word and then start saying, brother, I think what God means here is this, or what God means there is that. No. When we read in God's word, when we say, brother, we only want the word, what we mean is we want to go from one scripture to the next, one scripture to the next, until the topic becomes clear, until we know upon two or three witnesses, the matter has now become clear. So that's why many theologians, they made blunders. Why? Because they thought, for you to understand the word, you need to know Hebrew language. They then went to learn the Hebrew language. Some they say, no, no, for you to understand God's word, you need to go and learn Greek. They then went and learned Greek. Meanwhile, it's not about Greek, it's not about Hebrew. God has to reveal his word to you. And most of the time, people have a tendency of mixing the word with other things. And when they mix the word with other things, the word loses its impact. That's why God in his sovereign grace has made it in such a way that in his plan, he will always send prophets, as we read in Amos chapter 3. Amos chapter 3, verse 7. It says here, surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servant, the prophet. You can see how he did it. You can go to Haggai. I'll show Haggai. Yeah, you can read Haggai 1. It's just to see how the Lord, even Haggai 2, verse 1, how the word came to the prophet, and so on. But let's not go much into those details. But notice first, when the word has been misinterpreted, in order to help the people, God always sends prophets. And when God sends prophets, the main purpose for that is for God to reveal what he really means, what he has said. But most of the time, whatever God says, God himself will make it clear for you. He will make it clear for me. So that's why when you read something in the Bible, if you don't understand it, leave it. Look for other Bible passages that talks about the same thing. Go from here, go from there, go from there, until you start getting the entire picture, then things will become clear of one. But when you read You start going, brother, I think what it means here is this, and then you start giving your own opinion. That opinion, with time, might become in itself a hindrance. Why? Because you may end up giving an explanation or adding your own opinion to something which actually is not the right thing. If we read in Genesis chapter 2, we can see how it all began in Genesis chapter 2 from verse 17. The Bible says this in Genesis chapter 2. It reads, "And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden." What am I reading? 17, sorry, verse 17. "But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die." So we can see there the commandment that the Lord God gave to Adam. He explained well. He said to him, verse 16, "And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die." Brothers and sisters, notice first, here we have what the Lord God himself said. We have what the Lord spoke about. We have it here. Right now you and I have it in a written form. But in the days of Adam, it was the spoken word. The Lord just came and spoke to Adam. "Of all the trees of the garden, you can freely eat. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it. For the day that thou shalt eat thereof, thou shalt surely die." It was there written black and white. And one would come and say, "Brother, it is written. It's clear. It's very clear. I've got it. I know what it means." Eve was there. Eve later, Adam passed what the Lord had commanded to her. He explained what God said. But in Genesis chapter 3, there we see the enemy. When the enemy came, the enemy did not distance himself from the topic. He remained on the subject, but the content, we read from chapter 3, from verse 1. "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, as God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die, for God does know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as God, knowing good and evil." Brothers, notice one thing. We've said the seed is the word. And the Apostle Paul gave us a good warning in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1. The Apostle Paul put it this way. "Moreover," keep your Genesis, we'll go back. "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved. If ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. In other words, so when you believe, you must remain within the boundaries. You must remain within the given area. Don't go over, otherwise you will have believed in vain, but remain within what God has told you. In short, what God has spoken unto us, what God has given us in the Word, as we've read in John 12. Because remember, God will not judge you for something He did not reveal to you. No. But first, He has spoken. And the Lord said, the word that I've spoken unto you, that word is what will judge you. So in short, we will be judged by the word. But that word, we must keep that word within the parameters or the guidelines. Don't go over, but stay within what God has told you, as the Apostle Paul said. But here, Adam was a free man. Eve was a free woman. When the devil came, he also came with the word. But he tweaked the word. He then changed. God said, the day you will eat, you will die. The devil said, no, you will not die. Because God knows, the day you will eat, you will become, you will know good and evil. You will become like God. So Eve was now standing in front of two things. What God spoke and the way the serpent understood. If this was written, Eve could refer to the text and read what God said. But here, she was facing someone who seems to have understood what God had said. And what he understood was the exact opposite of what God had said. And what will you do? Remember, in the natural, the men of God spoke about the virtues that God gave to a woman. The men of God, when he started going in the virtues that God gave to a woman, he mentioned three things. He said God gave to a woman the motherhood, the virginity, and also the maternity and being a mother, and he gave also this ability to be virgin and so on, but I can't remember the third.
Femininity.
Yes, to be like a woman. Yeah, let me write down so that it makes more sense. These things are very important. They are important. Keep bear with me. Yes. Virginity. And also, we say femininity, but it comes from the word femininity if it exists. Anyway, but these three things, God gave these virtues to a woman, and she needs to keep all of them really seriously. A woman has the ability to give birth and be a mother to the children. A young lady or girls, when they are born in this world, they are born virgins. And the femininity here is just that ability of a woman to be as a woman, meaning to have a spirit of a woman. A woman has a completely different nature to men. Why? Because of the way God made her. So a woman needs to keep that spirit in her. she's a bit reserved, and so on. Now these virtues, they also apply to the church. In the church of God, the church must be able to be a place where people can come and experience the new birth. They come to hear the word, as we read in 1 Timothy, the church is the pillar and the ground for the truth. Amen. When people come here, they must be able, they come, they hear the pure word. Why? Because we are here only to defend the truth. Only the word, nothing else. At the same time, the church must be virgin, meaning virgin from all the wrong teaching. So we cannot be here believing any kind of teaching, no. Because when we believe a false doctrine, before God, we've already lost our virginity. The femininity is the ability for the church to keep the Spirit of God in the church. So when we pray and pray, it's because we want to keep God's Spirit in the church. And when the church doesn't pray, the church becomes dry, and the Spirit of God will no longer be there. But now notice, in the natural, the purpose why God gave all these virtues, when a man, this, when we look at the first Adam, when God gave Adam a wife, the purpose of that relationship was to allow Adam to reproduce himself through Eve. So Eve was meant to be there so that Adam could reproduce himself through Eve. Remember again what we have said, the word is the seed. So through Eve, Adam was going to produce another Adam, and so on. But before it happened, Eve had already fallen with the serpent. But the last Adam, to him also, he was given a bride. And this time, the bride that the last Adam was given is the church. And the purpose of that bride is for the last Adam to reproduce himself. Because he is the word being the seed, he needs to reproduce himself and produce another seed, which is the word. But before it happened, the church also has fallen. I don't know if it makes sense to you. In short, brothers, because here we are talking about the word. So the purpose of the church is for the word to be sown in the church so that other sons and daughters of God can be born from that word and from the Spirit of God. And if these things do not happen, Isaiah 26 that we have read will always be there. So we will be believers, but not believers that are meeting the expectation of God. So we will come here, we sing, we rejoice, we praise God. But brother, God is not interested just in the singing. God is not only interested in the worship, no. God wants to see sons and daughters that are born from the incorruptible seed of his word. But those people, where are they? That's why when we go back to Genesis chapter 2 and Genesis chapter 3, first we see how the enemy came. The enemy spoke to Eve. The enemy twisted the word. The enemy sowed the doubt in Eve. The enemy confused Eve. While Eve was trying to reason, what do you mean? So you mean if we eat, we won't die? Yes, you won't die. If you eat, you will be like God. If you eat, you will know evil or good and bad. If you eat, you will gain more wisdom. The more Eve was hearing the serpent talk, Eve became convinced that what the serpent was saying was true, If you read in Genesis chapter 3, she then saw that the tree was good to aspire or to desire. She then took out of it and ate. And Adam also came and ate. If you read down, the Bible says their eyes were open. But though their eyes were open, at that moment, they were separated from God. So with eyes open and yet separated from God, they then realized that they were naked, but it was too late. If we go to Matthew chapter 4, look what the Bible says. In Matthew chapter 4, we read. Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungry. And when the tempter came to him, he said, If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Then the devil takes him up into the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Jesus said unto him, It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Let me look in Psalm 91. Psalm 91. Psalm 91. Psalm 91. Let's read verse 11. Psalm 91. Psalm 91 from verse 11 is written, For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hand, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Amen.
Amen.
Brothers, what the devil quoted was a promise that was written in God's word. It's written in the Psalm, how he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. That was the promise already given. But here, the enemy is saying here, on verse 5 of Matthew 4, Then the devil takes him up into the holy city and set him on a pinnacle of the temple, and said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, it means first he's questioning whether he is really the Son of God. And then he goes, Cast thyself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hand they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. You can just read the text, and then you jump with the text. All right, okay. Now that I'm on top of the temple, because it is written, I can throw myself, as it is written, He will protect me. No. But the Lord knew. He knew what the devil wanted. The devil wanted him to obey him. He's giving the instructions to the Lord for the Lord to obey him. And yet the Lord cannot do what the devil instructed him. The Lord resists him. Why? Because he took the word out of its context and then he gave it to him. It is written, if thou be the Son of God, we all know, for you to become the Son of God, John 1, to all those who believe in him, to them gave he the power to become sons and daughters of God. You don't become a son of God by jumping from the mountain and then the Lord protects you. No. But rather you become a son or a daughter of God by believing the word. Amen. So that's why, brothers and sisters, even if somebody comes with concordance, he quotes the written word. And this is where many people fall in the trap. Because they read the Bible, the Lord say, you are searching the scripture, and yet you think you have life eternal in them. But if the same scriptures that talks about me, why? Because people fail to understand that when God says something, you and I, we don't have to explain it. We just need to wait upon the Lord until the Lord himself gives the meaning. Look what happened with Nebuchadnezzar. He had a dream. He did not know the meaning. But for him to understand what the Lord said, it took a prophet to come and give him the meaning of what the Lord had told him in a dream. Pharaoh had a dream that related to God's plan. For him to understand what God meant, it took a prophet to come and explain to him what God meant. In short, brothers and sisters, the world is in a chaos because the people have not allowed God to do what himself has expressed through the word. People have come up, brother, he said, let us create men in our image. No, no, here God is talking to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. Look, this means there is Trinity. No, 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 no. Don't try to explain the word. You have read there, read also other places. When God say, let us go, whom is he talking to? Let the word give you the understanding. But unfortunately, men are not patient enough. Men want an answer there and then. No, no, no. And then he goes into the Greek, he goes into the Hebrew, he reads, oh brother, these words are synonym, these words are, no. God gives meaning to his own word.
Amen.
What God wants you and I is just to pray. Why? Because these men, they were moved by the Spirit. Daniel did not tell Nebuchadnezzar, you tell me your dream. Nebuchadnezzar told him, oh, Nebuchadnezzar, I think what you dream, no. He told Nebuchadnezzar, give us time. Why? Because since it came from God, the meaning also needed to come from God. Brothers, the entire Bible is like that. Don't think you can just take the Bible and start reading and understanding it on your own. No. God has to reveal. God has to open the way. We read one case again. Let's pick Matthew chapter 1. Let's speak also Isaiah 7. I'll start maybe with Isaiah. Let me go to Matthew 1. Isaiah 7, verse 14, it reads, therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. And then we read in Matthew 1, from verse 18, it reads, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make a public example, was minded to put her away privately. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary, thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost." Notice, brothers, the battle that Joseph had, that battle is the battle that many people today struggle with. Why? Because, first, Mary at that time, what had happened to Mary in Israel, when you are a fiancé, engaged to someone, and then you conceive, not by the fiancé, in Israel at that time, it was a death penalty. They need to stone you to death. Why? Because when you are engaged, if you read in Deuteronomy, when you are engaged to somebody and then you cheat behind them, in Israel at that time, they needed to stone such people to death. Now Joseph just learned when the Mary came and said, "Do you know what? The angel came and said to me these words, and then I will conceive not from a man, but I will conceive of the Holy Ghost." And then when Joseph checked, he realized that actually Mary was expecting. But then we read that Joseph decided to depart from Mary, but a little bit in private. So he was normally running away. "I don't want to get to be involved with you anymore." Why? Because I'm not the responsible. Said to Mary was in agreement or in line with what Isaiah the prophet had already announced. Isaiah spoke years ago that a virgin will conceive, and that will be a sign. A virgin will conceive. Now, how did God interpret what he had spoken through Isaiah? It's by choosing Mary, a virgin, and then allowing a virgin to conceive without knowing a man. But to Joseph, that was beyond. Brothers, you know, today, when you speak with people about the word, they get offended. You tell them that, brother, God even in our time, he still uses men. God still sends even prophets. It was written in Malachi 4:5, that before the dreadful day of the Lord comes, I will send you Elijah the prophet. They said, no. The last prophet in the Bible was John the Baptist. But they forget that the apostle Paul was also a prophet. Paul did not receive the word the way Timothy received it. No. The Lord revealed the word to Paul in the same way he revealed the word to Moses. Why? Because, brother, in the New Covenant, the Apostle Paul read the book of Galatians. He explained how he went in Arabia. In 1 Timothy, in 1 Corinthians 11, Paul said, "The things which I've written unto you, I've received them from the Lord." So the Lord revealed them to him. Why? Because the word does not go to a pastor. God does not reveal the mysteries to pastors, no. But rather, he reveals his word to the prophet. Amen. Then these other ministries, they can now be fed. There are people who feel, "Oh, no, brother. God also reveals me the word." No. Be careful. Why? Because when we say the word comes to the prophet, what we mean is the meaning, the context, how to apply the word. That context, God gives it to the prophet.
Amen.
Why? Because You can still have the written word, and yet you completely misunderstand it. Look at all the messengers throughout the ages. When you take all of them, right? We read in Act 2. We read in Matthew 28. When you read Matthew 28, let me read it again. Let's just take these two scriptures. Matthew 28. And then let's take Acts chapter 2. Let's take the two at the same time. Matthew 28 and Acts chapter 2. We read in Matthew 28, verse 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And then in Acts chapter 2, from verse 37, it reads, now when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, brother, one would say, oh, but that's straightforward. But what the theologians did was to take the two scriptures, instead of seeing the two scriptures as one is completing the other, they then oppose them. They then say, brother, between Peter and Jesus, whom should we follow? Should we follow what Jesus said, or should we follow what Peter said? They then take Act 2 and Matthew 28, they oppose them. It became as if what Jesus said, Peter misunderstood it. Meanwhile, Peter did not misunderstand. Peter understood exactly what the Lord said. Why? Because the Lord said, go and baptize them in the name. But unfortunately, these are things, my brethren, when God sends a prophet, when the prophet comes, the word comes to the prophet. The prophet then understands what God means. He then shares it with all the people. But unfortunately, brother, we are living in a world whereby people have interpreted the word. People have completely changed the meaning of the word. And now we have churches that are blessing receptions. And when you talk to them, they tell you, oh, no. It's you people who don't understand. When God said men should not take another man, oh, no. You don't understand what the Bible means there. At that time, God was referring to a certain group of people. That's not applicable in the new covenant. No, brethren. Let's leave the word in its original context. Otherwise, many topics we can touch, but we will still go step by step. If we take Ephesians 4, verse 5, maybe verse 4 and 5, Ephesians 4, verse 4 and 5, there is one body and one spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of the calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. So here we are told, the apostle is writing, that there is only one Lord, one God, one hope, one body, one faith, and so on. The list is long. And then, when you start now going in a little detail, who is the Lord? How did the Lord reveal himself or manifest himself? And then when you start reading, then you can see, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and that Word was made flesh. You don't need to explain. You don't need to go, oh no, brother, because there it's written, the Father and here the Son. What this means, there are two persons. So one is the Father, and the second one is the Son. No. You read all the scriptures, go one verse to the next, let the word itself explain itself. Why? Because if you start giving context or meaning using your own opinion, you will be misled. That's why what God wants us to do first is to come out. Come out of all that you know. Let God teach you. Come out of your preconceived knowledge so that God can teach you. Why? Because we tend to come and then maintain or keep our old knowledge. Now when God is teaching you, you start now mixing what you knew with what God is teaching you. At the end, the word is now mixed. Jesus said in John 3, you must be born again. Whoever is not born again, he cannot understand things of the kingdom. He cannot enter in the kingdom of God. But brothers, go and talk to people and ask them. They will tell you, me, I'm a born again Christian. Me, I'm a born again Christian. There is even a church called the Church of the Born Again. Meanwhile, to be born again is not a title.
No.
To be born again is an experience. Whoever is born of God, brother, what that means? You are born of the incorruptible seed of God. As Mary received the word in a virgin womb, and the Spirit of God overshadowed Mary, and then the Son of God was born, when you are born again, what that means, you did receive the incorruptible seed of God in your soul, and the Spirit of God came and overshadowed you so that the new man could be born in you. And if that is not the case, brothers and sisters, we are still in the time of grace. Let me tell you, if you have not experienced a genuine experience of the new birth, all your efforts, they will not be in vain. Isaiah 26 will be applicable to you. You will be like that woman who goes to the maternity. She's there crying and crying and crying. Oh, why? Because of the birth pain. When the time of delivery comes, there is only wind. No baby is born. You are there mourning. We come here, let's pray. You are praying louder. You pray, you pray, you pray. And then when you go back, your life doesn't change. You are still the same person. That's why, brothers and sisters, the divine nature is only for those who are born by the Word and the Spirit of God. If your tendency, you are ever leaning toward the things of the world, I want you to know, it's because you are not born of God. When you are genuinely born of God, the desire in you, the passion, you will always be longing for holiness. Why? Because you are born by the Word, you are born by the Spirit of God. That desire in you, it is something you cannot fabricate. No, it is something that God gives you. Because you are born of God, He gives you a new heart, He gives you a new spirit, and then He comes to put His own spirit in you so that you now can walk in His ways. And when you walk in the ways of God, you are happy. Look today, the biggest trouble people have, it's because those who are leading them, first themselves, they've never experienced the salvation of the soul. Themselves, they don't know the perfect will of God. How will you now be able to help others? Brother, read Matthew 28, read Luke 24, read Acts chapter 1. The Lord took time. The Lord took time to teach His own disciples. The Lord took time to make sure that they understand every single word. He even asked them, have you understood everything? They said, yes, Lord. And then after that, the Lord said to them, go and teach all nations. Before you can even go and teach others, Let the Lord first teach you. But unfortunately, many theologians went just to Bible schools. They sat there, they taught them. When you read about Paul, every lesson Paul received from Gamaliel, instead of it opening his eyes, it was bringing more darkness. It was blinding him even more and more, to a point whereby when the Lord came down, all the Pharisees, none of them could even recognize him. His disciples, Paul could not understand them. He was ready to go and persecute them. The churches, they were ready to go and then reject him. Brothers, because of many interpretations, when the Lord came, his own did not recognize him. At the end, they took him and crucified him. The one who came to save them, they took and crucified him. History is repeating itself. So my advice for today, brothers and sisters, first, let's calm down and step back a little bit, examine ourselves. The believers of Berea, they were searching the word, trying to find out the things Paul was teaching them, whether they were so. Why? Because, brother, don't ever think by mixing the word with your ideas, or me, I think, or in my opinion, or for me, or no. We only want to take the original word on every topic, brother. How to marry, take all the subject. How to live in marriage, take all the topic. How to behave, take the written word and read the Bible in prayer. Why? Because the more you read, look what God has done. God has given us his word. He sent us a prophet. And when the prophet came, imagine the tendency when you want to choose a church. You look at the size, you look at the community, what kind of people are in that church, the people from my country, are they there? People who speak my language, are they there? People of my race, are they there? When all these questions are met, there are people who speak my language, there are people, if I have a problem, will help me. And then you see someone comes to a conclusion, this will become my church. But brother, God sent us a man of God with the word. And then this man of God, when he preached the word, he said, no, if you want to choose a church, look for the church where the pure word of God is preached. Even if outside that church does not look impressive, as long as the word is there, that is the church of God. Oh no, brother, the people who go there, they drive big cars. People who go there, they are rich, they are very influential. Then I will go there. No. But rather, we want the church that will teach us the ways of God. The church that will help us to get closer to God. Otherwise, you follow people, brother, as we read in Matthew 7, broad or large is the way that men go in. But that is the way of perdition. But the narrow way, only very few will find, and very few will walk in the narrow way. So that's why, first, let us ask ourselves. We saw in Matthew 4 how the devil came. It's written. But brother, there are many topics we'll go through each at one stage. You read, especially in this message, there are people who came up with some conclusion. No, what this means is this. What that means? No, but Paul was telling Timothy, preach the word. The word is what is written. And we first find God's word in the written form in the Bible. It's that written word that God sent the prophet to come and reveal. Now today we can read the written word, but we have it in a revealed way. So when we read, we understand what the Lord means. So that's why it's so important first we familiarize ourselves with what is written. And we believe things as they are written in the Bible. If you want to give me an explanation, not your explanation. If I read, brother, the Lord will return. Fine. Show me where it is written. I can read. To you, 1 Corinthians 15. we will not all die, but in the twinkling of an eye, we will all be transformed. I can then go to 1 Thessalonians 4. I can read you, brother, don't worry about those who are dead in Christ. Why? Because that will happen. I can go to Matthew 25. We can read many scriptures here and there that shows that one day the Lord will return. John 14, let not your heart be troubled. Why? Because all those scriptures, they speak about his return. If it's about judgment, we can go in 1 Corinthians, in Romans, we can read about the judgment. So there are many scriptures for every topic. But the unfortunate thing is the devil has not left those scriptures in their original context. The devil has, oh no, the rapture has already taken place. Oh, when did it take place? Oh no, when the cloud appeared to William Branham, that's when the rapture took place. But how? Yes, brother, because by then he came in the word form. In the word form, yes, he came in the word form. But how? He came as a cloud. But what does the scripture say? So now when we go in the scripture, this Jesus that you've seen going up, in the same manner, he will also return in the way you've seen him going up. So then, that is one part. The second part, we will all be transformed. And when the rapture takes place, mortality will take an end. So we will no longer die. So we will no longer fall sick. So today, if we are falling sick, it's because the rapture has not taken place. So there are things, brother, if you don't familiarize yourself with the word, you will do the way Eve did. She had the word, but the devil came. Is it really written? Did really God say it? No. God knows. Why? Because the day you will eat, you will be like God. You will be there, shaken now on your ground. You don't now know what to do. It's like the infinite grace. With the infinite grace, they say, no, brother, don't do anything. God will do everything for you. Don't do anything. You are there, you are watching a dirty movie, and then instead of changing the channel, you say, no. You just watch it. Why? Because when God will remove that desire in you, even if you are watching it, nothing will happen. No. You are defiling yourself. So there are things God has given us, the free moral agency. We can decide, we can change, we can do things. If I know going this path can mislead me or lead me to a fall, I stop, I change the direction. Oh no, brother, because me I'm, filled up, I can go, nothing will happen. No, you are tempting God. That's what the Lord said. It is also written, and don't tempt the Lord thy God. So it is also written. So may the Lord help us. And this is where Brother Frank's ministry comes into account. Brothers and sisters, this ministry, you may not realize what God has done. If you look at the nature of the two ministries, when you read Brother Branham's ministry and you see how Brother Branham's ministry operated, and you see how Brother Frank's ministry is operating, you will come to see the beauty of how God does things. First, God gave the meaning of the word. God gave the context of the word. So what it means. You read about Joel 1, Joel 2, how the church was attacked with fake teaching, wrong teaching, and how the life in the church almost disappeared. And then toward the end, God has restored. Amen. God has given the word. And then, but the way the word was restored, brother, it's like flood. The word was given in its fullness. Like the flood, whereby there was everything was upside down, and now everything was restored, but not in order. So there are things, but yet they are all part of the house. But they were all damaged by the work that the devil did. Now God, in his wisdom, he now sent a teacher. A teacher comes, he finds everything is already restored, but it's just not where it should be. Now the teacher starts. He takes what belongs to the kitchen and directs it straight to the kitchen. He takes what belongs to the bedroom, directs it to the bedroom. He takes what belongs to the living room, directs it to the living room. And when he does it, He does it not with one scripture, no. He does it with 5, 10, 20 scriptures. And when you read, you can truly see that actually this belongs here, that belongs there, this belongs here, this event will happen before the rapture, this event happened after the rapture, this event is happening right now. Why? Because, remember, men were moved by the Spirit. They did not speak by themselves, no, but they were moved by the Spirit. That's why when you read most of Brother Frank's books, when he write at the end, when he signs, he put on behalf, from the Lord. He put that signature. Why? Because today you and I have this Bible complete. In the days of the apostles, they never used to have Bibles. They used to have letters. Paul would write a letter. That letter would be read in the church of Corinth. And then the same letter will be read in the church of Thessalonica. The same letter will go to the church of Philadelphia or wherever. Why? Because they did not have a complete book. But brother, we are seeing again almost the same operation, whereby what God spoke to us through the prophet and now through the teaching ministry, we are able to see things. I was saying to my wife yesterday and my kids, even the courage to recycle seems to be dying now. Why? Because, brother, all this effort we are putting in, 5 bins, yellow bins, green bins, black bin, white bin, bin for paper, bin for general food, bin for, I don't know, whatever. We are doing that with which goal? To save the environment. But God has already spoken. The moon will be 7 times. So whether we do it, whether we don't do it, whether we pray or we don't pray, brother, one day what we read in Revelation 6 from verse 12, what we read in Isaiah 30, one day it will happen. We don't mean go now, start throwing bottles on the road because it will happen. No. It's because when God speaks, what he has said will come to pass. Let there be light. Imagine if we could take Billy Graham, Oran Roberts, Jimmy Swaggart, all these big men, if we could take them all back in the book of Genesis 1, and then God came down and spoke, let there be light. How long did it take? Nobody knows. Let there be light. Brother, if you read Genesis 1, the Bible says, darkness covered the whole earth. There was confusion, darkness all over. And the Lord God spoke, let there be light. Now, because it was still dark, one could go and start explaining what God has said here. Let there be light. What that means is, God is trying to do ABC. You could go and give your own explanation. That was still going to be wrong. The only thing to do was hold your peace. God has spoken. Let us wait upon God to achieve what he intended, what he meant. But we read, let there be light, and that light appeared. So whenever God says something, don't explain it. Leave it, wait for it, it will come to pass.
Amen.
As he said, I will send you Elijah the prophet. No need to explain. Wait, in God's time, he then sent Elijah the prophet. And then when God fulfilled, even your eyes, you will be able to tell, brother, this man is actually the one that the Lord promised. How did the woman at the well recognize Jesus? She heard him, he spoke, she then said, we were told, when the Messiah will come, he will do these things. How did she know? It's because when God fulfilled his word, brother, even the inner part of you, you will know that this word is the truth. It's like this message. We don't have any shadow of doubt that this message is the perfect will of God for this time. Whoever rejects this message, brother, you will not see them in the rapture. It's impossible. If you read John 1, it says, those who believed through John, all of them were the ones who were saved. So the same today. So you have no escape. But we will continue. The main goal of this little topic is to raise our awareness first to the written word. Brother, sister, it is your right to question me. Brother, what you say there? Where is it written? Brother, what you say there? Where is it written? It is your right. Why? Because it is, don't just sit there and take it. No, it is your right to question. Brother, I heard the word. You say this. We should not be walking without shoes. From now on, where is it written? It is your right. Don't just sit there and say, oh, after all, the preacher said, and then we go like that. No, no, it is your right. It's also my right to make sure that you feed only on the word. It's also my right to come and ask you, but what you are doing, where have you seen it? Where have you seen it? Brother, you start worshiping idol. Where have you seen it? And because remember, we don't put signs before the word. We put the word before anything. So it is your right to come and ask me, brother, you did preach this, you did preach that, but where is it written? So that's why it's so important. It's your responsibility. For me, is to preach the word and make sure I only preach the word. But your responsibility is only to believe what comes from the word. Anything that is not from the word, leave it aside. Why? Because, brother, sister, I want us to reach that level whereby, because it is written, I believe it. I don't believe it because Brother Branham said it. I don't believe it because Brother Frank said it. No. I believe it because the word said it. And it says it not only in one place, not two, no, because remember, the revealed word has opened for us the Bible. Amen. Brother, this message has opened for us the Bible. This week, I did send a little video of a Thunder preacher in Congo. I don't know who made the video, because it's in French, I could not send it to English speakers. But in that video, they took Brother Branham's statement, and they took that message statement, where Brother Branham is talking about the seven seals and seven thunders, where Brother Branham is saying the seven thunders are not revealed, nobody knows the content. This thunder believer saying, no, 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 no. There, Brother Branham made a mistake. No, 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 no. Here, Brother Branham misunderstood. And then I was confused. I then sent it to another fellow believer. It kind of troubled him. That video seems to be raising some questions in many Thunder believers. And I thank God that it can do so. Why? Because, brother, sister, only believe what you can read.
Amen.
And if it's not written, we leave it to God. May the Lord bless us all.
Amen.